go ahead, Larry, with your comments. N4ROQ from W1WCR.
Okay, thank you, Vic. It looks like ISIS is still working pretty hard over there with all the jets, the Russian jets, and the U.S. guys over there, and the Iranian guys coming in. They managed to, ISIS, they blowed up three captives with ancient sites. I got this through the World News here. In Beirut, it came from Beirut, the Islamic State group killed three of its captives in Syria's ancient city of Palmyra by tying them to Roman-era columns at the site, then blowing the structures up with explosives. Activists said Tuesday that Palmyra explosions were the latest method of killing by Islamic State militants, known for beheadings, immolation, and drowning of prisoners. A Palmyra activist who goes by the name Nasser Al-Thayer said that the killings of the three natives, or the three captives, excuse me, took place on Monday afternoon at the Palmyra archaeology site located a few miles away from the city. Al-Thayer and the British-based Syrian Observatory for Human Rights, which relies on a network of activists on the ground, said the three were civilians, but their identities remain unknown. So that's a terrible way to die, but they picked the worst. Let's see, teenager, this is going to Oregon here. So they do found a case here, a teenager diagnosed with bubonic plague in Oregon. Died with bubonic plague, the illness that killed tens of millions of people in the 14th century, but is treatable today. Oregon health officials said the Crook County girl is believed to have acquired the disease from a flea bite during a hunting trip near Morrow County. The trip started in October 16th. She fell ill 5 days later and was hospitalized three times after that. The unnamed girl is recovering. Evidently, she hasn't died yet, but is still in intensive care. The plague is treatable with antibiotics if caught early. Symptoms of the bubonic plague, the most common form of the bacterial infection, include high fever, lethargy, and swollen lymph nodes. According to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, an average of 7 human plague cases are reported each year in the United States. So I'd mention that. Looks like GM is recalling 1.4 million cars with fiery oil leaks. Let's see, General Motors is recalling cars that can leak oil and catch fire, in some instances damaging garages and homes. The recall, which covers 1.4 million vehicles dating to the 1997 model year, is needed because repairs from the first two recalls didn't work. More than 1,300 cars caught fire after they were fixed by dealers. The company says in the previous recalls in 2008 and 2009, General Motors told owners to park the cars outside until repairs can be made, since most of the fires happened shortly after drivers turned off the engines. A spokesman was checking to see if the same recommendation applies this time. GM will notify owners of 500,000 more cars that were not repaired in the previous recall. The latest recall, mainly in North America, includes the 97 through 2004 Pontiac Grand Prix, Buick Regal, and Buick Regal, the 2000 through 2004 Chevrolet Impala, the 1998 and 99 Chevrolet Lumina and Oldsmobile Intrigue, and the 1998 through 2004 Chevrolet Monte Carlo all have 3.8 liter V6 engines. over time a valve cover gasket can degrade, allowing the oil to seep out. Under hard braking, oil drops can fall onto the exhaust manifold and catch fire. Flames can spread to a plastic spark plug wire channel and to the rest of the engine. So be sure if you've got a problem there, is get your gaskets replaced there on that particular vehicle. You can burn down your house. That's all I've got at this time, Vic. We'll turn it back to you, W1WCR and the Great Liberty Net, and for ROQ.
I should think that instead of recalling all those GM vehicles, they ought to supply the GM owners with fire extinguishers.
Yeah, that ought to be standard equipment.
Well, they could have fire extinguishers as the standard piece of equipment. In fact, they could have a sprinkler system installed in the car, and that would take care of it.
Yeah, that's right. It looks like it takes a few years for that gasket to erode, and then when it does, it oil goes all over the motor and it burns it up.
Something gets overheated, I guess. Maybe it's fuel splashing on a hot engine.
Yeah, well, it will ignite also if it gets down on some stuff that will burn, like an exhaust manifold, and then catches fire, it'll spread to the gasoline sections and all, too.
Yeah, I guess that would make quite a scene in the neighborhood when that happens. Anyway, we'll keep moving. I've got Jim next, W3JMD. Take her away.
Okay. Not a lot, but basically what it comes down to is with the influx of a different culture into the European mix, a number of things have been occurring. And in Austria, they have sold out all of the guns. You and I, and I think it was Steve, had talked about this earlier, but I'll throw this in for the net tonight. Austrians have basically bought up all of the guns available on the shelves in their country because of the possibilities that can occur when you have a large influx of Muslim males that don't seem to be family oriented, and nor do they seem to be a part of a mix of what you would call normal refugees. You know, the family ain't there. You got these young males coming in, and let's just say the Austrians are looking at it for what it is. I think the Europeans are looking at it for what it is. This is not a normal mix. This is a situation that's going to be problematic in the making. And so the Austrians have bought all of the long guns, short guns, pistols, rifles, shotguns, you name it. The shelves are bare. And Alan Gottlieb, head of the Second Amendment Foundation here in America, was over in Europe last week talking with a number of people in the given countries. And his take on it was they wish they had a Second Amendment in Europe. So it looks like the whole game has come full circle. The king has outlawed the swords, and the people are saying, we're going to buy the swords anyway. W3JMD.
Yes, you can hardly blame them. In some cases, there are small villages with only a few hundred population, and they're dumping thousands of Muslims on these people. And I don't know how they expect these villagers to take care of a swarm of anti-European visitors like that.
Well, and especially when they bring their own culture and they refuse to assimilate into the culture with where they've been displaced. That is absolutely wrong, no matter how how you can cut it. And I saw the articles where they were like a village of several hundred people, literally well below 1,000, well below 500, 200-300 people, and they bring in a couple thousand of these immigrants. What the hell is on somebody's mind to think that this assimilation is going to be real? This is a problem in the making, and I certainly hope that the people in that village, that small village, I hope the village survives, is I guess what I want to say. I hope that small village survives, because it certainly sounds as if the powers that be have set out to destroy a number of the local cultures. W3JMD.
Yes, they sure have. In Switzerland, incidentally, what they've been doing with unwanted immigrants is they put them on board an airliner, and they fly them down to Nigeria. And in most cases, they have to actually handcuff them and tie them down to the seats, because they get violent very quickly. So they, and I've watched the video of the Swiss police taking these guys up the steps into the aircraft, and you can see that there's a struggle going on as they force them into the aircraft. But it gets rid of them, and in the long run, it saves a lot of money, it saves a lot of trouble, and it saves a lot of social disorder over.
Yeah, actually, yes. Actually, I put them on an Airbus and keep flying them back and forth until one of the Airbuses crashes. I heard a comment earlier about how the Russian airliner dropped, and that that's payback or karma for Putin. But it still has not been determined that Putin had any responsibility, or Russians for that matter, or the rebel forces in Ukraine had any responsibility for that whatsoever. Especially when you look at the cockpit area of the fuselage, where they had bullet holes going in and out, essentially, from both sides. So it certainly didn't look like a missile attack. It looked like the thing had been hit by two jets coming in from either side and riddling the thing with gunfire. That would basically say that it was the Ukrainian forces, something that we were backing, that caused the downing. And since we have not released anything in that regard, it looks kind of strange. Had we released all of the information that we had, I would say that it would probably be the Russians' fault. But we released nothing. That, to me, our release of no information, and we certainly had satellites and other things viewing down from above at that point in time, speaks volumes. W3JMD.
Yes, it's a chaotic situation so far, and I think we're going to have to wait a while before we figure out exactly who did what to whom.
You know, and that's unfortunate, Vic. It is extremely unfortunate that we have to wait a while and wait till events pass to the point where we're, I mean, I probably won't be on this earth myself. You yourself may not, and a number of others, before the truth ever gets vetted properly. And that just sucks so bad. W3JMD.
And that it does, I have to admit. And with that, we'll move back to David in Peoria, Illinois, KB9 KBC. It's your turn.
They don't care.
much of it. Can someone really?
Well, his comment was this country as a whole is doped up, drunked up, whored up. Most people don't give a flip. Most people aren't aware. Well, I've got your attention there, Vic. Could I get a quick RST signal check? I think you said 9 plus 5 earlier. This is KD0WSJ.
Yes, you're quite loud here. I'm not sure how many over S9, but it's way over the noise level. I know that.
Okey-dokey. Now, that was the relay. He's just commenting that this country has gone to hooey. Everybody's doped up and nobody gives a flip.
Yes, well, they're making dope legal in a lot of places, and it gets worse and worse. And they're using stuff that destroys the mind.
You're also 50 yards high, Michael. It's about the best I can do with this old Kenwood. It only shows me tenths, and I can only get her close. Another thing to keep in mind with the all the major cities, an increasing, continuing worldwide drought, they're increasingly using water from the rivers, and that water is from the city upstream, and increasingly using more recycled water. And it's, I think, 30 to 40% of the country is now on psychotropic drugs. Something like 60 to 70% are on several pharmaceutical drugs. Then you got women on birth control and all the other crap the pharmacy companies have pushed on America. And you cannot remove that stuff from the water. So all the recycled water, you're not just getting fluoride. Hey, buddy, you're getting some psychotropic dope, too. So all the cities are doped up. And in fact, everybody's on dope if you live in a city. And heck, even in the countryside, you got chemtrails coming up in the well water. That's why I'm using a Berkey with fluoride filters and a fluoride filter in the shower. KD0WSJ, back to Vic.
Yes, consider what it must do to the fish.
There ain't no fish left. Even Stockton Lake by me is dying off now.
Yeah, it's pretty sickening. Anyway, I'm at the end of my list once again, and let's see if there's anybody that wants to comment.